Hey there, gamers. I'm Pruitt, and it's Jim, and I've got to be honest. I just don't think I have the strength to do another pun-filled intro, and I certainly no longer have the mental dexterity. I'm sure your constitution's wearing thin on it as well, because I mean it's not really that intelligent to come up with these things, and I don't impart much wisdom. I mean, it's pretty much just an act of sheer charisma. I don't know that I can...
You shouldn't beat yourself up, man. We're just talking about action resolution and ability scores today.
Yeah, Jim, on WebDM. See what I did there? Okay, Jim, let's get back to basics, back to the foundation, back to where it all starts.
All begins.
Ability scores.
Ability scores, yeah.
Seem a bit like, you know, 5 years into the game and 4 years into the channel and everything to kind of go back over these. But, not, you know, sometimes going over the basics kind of reminds you.
Oh, certainly. Right? Yeah, yeah. It's often refreshing.
What to you kind of stands out in 5th edition?
I mean, how important they are, number one. Yeah. It really seems like ability scores in 5th edition are very important to just like the raw numbers of your character. And the reason why I say this is because it's possible to start with a higher ability score than your proficiency bonus, which to me suggests like, you know, they're looking at ability scores as being like the main driver of a lot of the statistical bonuses that you get. Mm-hmm. And because ability scores are tied to, you know, action resolution in terms of ability checks, and that's kind of like one of the building blocks of, you know, interaction with the game world. To me, they take too central of a role in 5th edition D&D, and I my personal preference would be to see them, you know, just toned down a bit, like every ability score maybe reduced by one or so, and the proficiency bonus knocked up by one, just to balance it a bit.
Like, hey, strength, stop flexing so much, babe.
Right. And mostly for me, it was a time, I forget what it was we were playing, and I had a character that was proficient in stealth and had a decent dexterity, but someone else just had like they were rolling, right? So that's probably one of the reasons why we were experiencing this. But like, they managed to start with a 20 in dex, and I'm over here like, wait a minute, they don't have proficiency in stealth. Like, how in the world are they better than my person who's like been trained and purposefully deliberately studied how to do this? And so to me it's incongruous, and I find it pulls me out of the game. I like role playing in which I don't necessarily have to feel like bound by my character sheet, you know, and I want to feel free to just sort of like explore the character and their interaction with the game world, and not like feel like I constantly have to refer back to this artifact of the game. And so I would prefer that they were less mechanically significant. But then that may not be D&D, right? Like, they've always been central to D&D, and maybe this is just like my pet peeve about D&D, and I can go play another game if I want to, which I do, and I will, so.
But the show must go on, as the old saying goes.
Right.
So, in current editions,
they
have kind of changed
a bit
from old, even like in the focus of like what are the main stats that you want.
Right, certainly, yes, yeah. And it's like, so if we're talking like ability scores, we go back far enough, ability scores are really there to give you a bit of an XP bonus if they're high enough. You'll get some kind of benefit, and in original D&D, they just have, it's like fifth, they just have like a plus associated with them. You know, you add this number to certain roles, or you know, if you have a high enough number, you add it to, say, your AC, something like that. They can have a significant impact on the game. My 5 charisma magic user was constantly broke because he had to pay everyone that worked for him double so that they wouldn't betray him and run away and like, you know,
don't be an asshole. I mean,
I thought it was a very good investment. You know, happy to pay it, but it did have an impact because I always had less money.
Yeah,
I couldn't buy my spells whenever I would gain a level. I'd have to save up a bit, and it influenced how I approached the game and how I changed it. But it wasn't as impactful as say. In the same way that 5th edition stats are, in that it's like, you know, every time I roll the dice, this thing's coming up. It just would come up occasionally and would sort of modify how I approach the game. That's classic D&D. As you move forward, ability scores get all sorts of things attached to them, so that by the time you get to like the end of 2nd edition, ability scores might have five or six things that they govern, and none of them are unified, and they're all basically a mini game.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. That was the fun part.
It was. I do, and I think there is a defense of non-unified mechanics in games that is valid. I'm not sure that I think a one-size-fits-all approach, which is essentially what a unified mechanic is the best way. But that's a whole other conversation for a different.
Yeah, I mean that's some game theory stuff right there about right. breaking up the monotony of what you do in the game
sure.
so that it feels new and yeah.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And there was millions or even hundreds of subsystems. It was more like, a handful, less than, to me, half a dozen once you...
Yeah, no, there were like five or six.
Yeah. But the reason why we go back to these editions is because we see their vestiges and their influence in modern D&D. And so, like, to me, when I look at, say, the fuzzy definitions of some of these ability scores, the fact that I look at wisdom and I see a mishmash and a crowded and disjointed ability that could be split up between other abilities and probably replaced with something that's more like perception and sort of like your connection with the gods as a function of your cleric ability or your druid ability or whatever. Your common sense is a function of you being a player, right? Like, there's a lot about specifically the wisdom score that is not even tied to your character sheet and is a function of like how you play the game. Is your character wise? Well, do you make good decisions about your character? And that has, to me, very little to do with the stat and more about how you want to play them.
Well, yeah, but I mean, by that logic, though, Jim, just to play devil's advocate here,
please.
People playing a fighter don't have high strength.
Sure.
So, again, it comes back to role playing.
Yeah.
I don't know if I'd hold that all over wisdom's head.
Not necessarily wisdom. My beef with wisdom specifically is that when people try to explain it, number one, everybody has their own definition of it. And largely this is a consequence of me late at night getting on Twitter and just saying something that I think will get a bunch of people talking,
Yeah, it was a fun thread.
All of this, I'm sorry, this entire episode and this entire idea came out of me going like, I should be able to play a monk that is based on intelligence instead of wisdom. I see the narrative of enlightenment and self-improvement and the like in the monk as much a function of intelligence, and I view this as like learning from your own experiences, being able to apply sort of like insight and not in the wisdom sense that you're sort of like, oh, they're wise and just sort of know things, but like you know things because you're experienced. You have a lot of time to reflect, a lot of time to think about things and introspection. To me, that's intelligence, not necessarily wisdom. And that's why I say...
The ability to process experiences.
Right, the ability to process experiences. And yet, some people would say that's wisdom. But wisdom for every edition of D&D has been weird. Sometimes it's common sense. Sometimes it's willpower. Sometimes it's faith. Sometimes it's perception and insight. And, because in TSR versions of D&D, you got a bonus to some saving throws based off of your wisdom score. That then became why wisdom was attached to the will saving throw in third edition. And then it gets to the will defense in fourth edition until we get to fifth edition. And wisdom saving throws govern things like hold person, which is like, you're trying to physically restrain someone. Why isn't that resisted by strength? Or like all the spells that take away your ability to control your character being keyed off wisdom instead of charisma, which is supposed to be a force of personality and like how much your presence fills up a room. To me, someone with a larger than life personality is going to be harder to charm. I know we're talking about saving throws now instead of ability checks, but sort of the same ballpark. But that's why I find these things just so fascinating to think about. I don't think necessarily any of this, I don't know. If I changed it, it wouldn't be D&D. These are the six stats that D&D has had since the beginning.
Yeah.
Sometimes they're in a different order. If you were to replace wisdom with perception or, something else, or introduce another one, you're not playing D&D. You're playing like a D&D adjacent game. Could be fun, but it's not the same thing.
Intelligence and judgment. I don't mean like...
Judgment, you see piety. Sometimes you've seen... more often than not, you see people add scores rather than replace them. Mm-hmm. I see honor, sanity, attractiveness. Those are all different scores that I've seen, but yeah. Let's stick to the big six.
Yeah, the big six. In past editions, there was more of a gravity associated with certain skills as to now.
Yeah.
It used to be like strength and intelligence were you know, you want to get that 18 double zero, mm-hmm. you want to get those bonus languages and all that.
Yeah, well, and especially for intelligence, it's like it governed how many spells you could know. Like, you know, wizards now in 5th edition, there's no max on the number of spells you can know. But in TSR versions, you know, 1st, 2nd edition D&D, if you have a low intelligence, you could still potentially, you know, become a mage, but you might only be able to know 7 spells per spell level. Or something like that, rather low. And your chance to learn those spells when you attempt to learn them is probably going to be pretty low. And so because those things weren't certain, you didn't get spells automatically whenever you leveled up. Intelligence was very important to mages, and they were important to the game because they had access to mage spells, which were awesome. And you know, just like tremendous power. And of course, by the end of 2nd edition, there were, you know, like thousands of them. Right. So you had a large selection to choose from. That was intelligence. Strength is the big one, though. You got to hit bonuses, double damage, you know, like if you got +3 to hit, you get +6 damage, bend bars, lift gates, all the kind of like interacting with the dungeon. Strength was king. You know, if you got an 18, you'd be hard pressed to be like, oh, just play a fighter, put that in strength and be a badass.
Yeah. And then roll those percentile dice back in the day.
Right. So
I think I got in the 90s one time for one character.
Before I started playing with the group, someone had rolled an 18 double zero.
It was
but
Josh.
They rolled 3 18s for their character, if I recall.
Yeah.
That was always a story that I was like,
Yeah, you rolled 3 18s and one of them you put in strength and got a double zero.
Yeah, so we'll see about that.
My favorite character ever, I think he was only like 1867 or something, but still, like, that was like solid. Like,
oh, yeah, yeah.
I mean, if you got to that threshold.
Yeah, if you got to that threshold.
You were solid.
It was worth it, yeah.
But yeah, but that's how it used to be. It was like jocks versus nerds, right?
Basically, that was the narrative, right? Yeah. Like that wizards were the nerds of D&D, and they started out weak and finished strong, and that the fighters were the jocks of D&D, and they're strong in early levels, and they get outpaced by the brainy. And that was just kind of the narrative of it. And I think it sort of like reflected the geek and nerd culture that D&D was a part of at the time. Maybe now you've replaced the jocks versus nerds dichotomy with the togetherness of the dance troupe and theater kids, the Dex and Charisma characters.
Yeah, yeah, because you know, Dex and Charisma, they're pretty much king now.
Yeah, I find most of my characters in 5th are Dex Charisma characters. You know, they are graceful, charismatic, charming, lithe, you know, athletic kind of adventurers. And intelligence is certainly not the stat it used to be.
Yeah.
Strength is not the stat it used to be in terms of just, you know, desirability for, you know, melee type characters. And so,
yeah, just grab a finesse weapon now. It's a common refrain.
Yeah, just grab a finesse weapon. It boosts your dex. It does this, you know. I still think you can get higher ACs with a strength build just because it's tough to get really high ACs with pure dex and like wearing leather or light armor. But even then, it's not like you're going to be significantly behind.
You need a high enough dex, you need a shield, you know, you need magic armor, and you can kind of hang. But if you're a fighter and you just finally get full plate, like,
yeah,
18
an 18 AC, and then you throw a shield on that and it's 20, and you don't even need any dex for that.
Sure. Yeah, that is sort of the benefit of the strength route still. So I mean, I'd say really it's intelligence is the stat that went from, oof, man, I used to hate having a negative intelligence modifier or even just like no modifier at all.
Right.
And now I'm like, am I one of the two classes that's going to use intelligence? Then I only will put my intelligence that I want to role play in there. It's entirely a role play stat now, unless I'm playing a wizard or mm-hmm. artificer or something like that, you know?
Yeah. But role playing your stats is important.
Certainly, yeah.
And that is... it's an aspect of the game. I mean, you were kind of discussing this earlier with wisdom and you know, how you make decisions. I always try, if I have a low wisdom, I usually play them reckless, okay, impulsive, yeah. Like, you know, no self-control.
Sure.
But how, like, you know, when players are thinking about role-playing their stats, what should be the driving focus?
Use them as guidelines and think of them in the same way that you might alignment. These are not hard and fast rules. Just because you have a low intelligence or a low wisdom doesn't mean necessarily that you are, particularly the mental stats, right? Like, it's easy to, you know, it's easy to say, like, yeah, I have a -2 modifier in strength. You know, I can't actually pretend I'm not weak, you know.
I'm not going to open that door. It's fine.
But for the mental stats, I am very much of the opinion that the player is the final arbiter of how they play their character. And the stats should be guidelines, the stats should be suggestions, and they can be they can reflect what the player wants from their character. But that really should never be like, oh, you got like a low wisdom or a low charisma or low intelligence. Obviously, what you as a player right now are describing is incongruent with what your character would do. I'm just like, yeah, that doesn't matter. The player is talking. The player is role-playing. If it needs to, it will come out when the dice are rolled. So as an example of this, if anybody out there follows Land Between Two Rivers, there's a goblin cleric on there played by Grant Ellis, our Twitch producer for WebGM, and he has a 8 charisma.
Yeah, I think it's 8.
And it's one of those things that I just kind of forgot about from when I audited the characters in the beginning, and then once we uploaded them all into D&D Beyond, it was like your goblin has an 8 charisma? And he doesn't play it that way at all. Constantly trying to schmooze, talk, this, whatever. And the way I rule that is that even when he rolls really well in an interaction, like, okay, you know, you rocked that, even if you know, you do have a negative, after the fact, his actions don't have a lasting impact, right? Like, it'd be different if he's coming in there with, like, a high charisma and, like, expertise and persuasion. It'd be one of those things where the impact of his words lasts a long time. Whereas now it's kind of like, yeah, in that moment, they're able to convince a person like, oh yeah, we'll go along with this. But as soon as he's gone, as soon as something else happens, that person goes like, wait a minute, why did I agree to do that? Whereas if that person was, like I said, a bard with a high charisma and proficiency and expertise and all the social skills, then I would rule like, oh no, like once you're gone, like that person's convinced, they're on your side.
Right.
And so I treat the things sort of temporarily. It'd be the same if it was someone with like a low intelligence who came up with a really great plan. It's like, even dum-dums have something good to say every now and then. Right, I don't mean to be rude, but it's like, everybody has moments of brilliance. Everybody has moments of where they go against what you think they can do, you know, and surprise you.
Idiot savants are a thing.
Sure, right? And like, it could just be that like, maybe they're not particularly good at a certain type of intellectual activity, and that's reflected in intelligence. It's not particularly well, I don't know what you'd call it, well socialized if they have a poor charisma, mm-hmm. you know, something like that. And you can allow the player to play the character the way they want and let the mechanics of the game when they come into play reinforce those things. Mm-hmm. The role play is one thing, and then, you know, the mechanics will come in there when they're needed. And so that's how I approach it. Guidelines and you know, letting the player make the final decision.
Okay, so when it comes to ability checks, in past editions, you had different kinds of checks.
Sure, yeah.
Right? And you have different kinds of checks in 5th edition, mm-hmm, but you mm-hmm. have 3, right?
Yep.
You got ability checks, you got saving throws, and you got attacks.
That's a outgrowth of the unified mechanic, I think.
Right.
3rd edition introduces the d20, which is, you know, roll a d20, add some modifiers, get above a certain number, equal to or above a certain number. It kind of like made everything in 3rd edition an ability check. Your saving throws are just like another ability check. It's your wisdom plus your saving throw bonus or whatever. Mm-hmm. It's, or, you know, your to hit roll is like your stat plus, you know, whatever your base attack bonus is. And so it kind of like, it unified everything in that regard, but it also would create these sort of moments where increasing your stats gave like all of these, you know, would have all these knock-on effects of like increasing everything else. And the fact that they were all one die roll meant that there's not a lot of nuance to it. And so with 5th edition, breaking up that unified mechanic into 3 separate roles, distinct roles, means that you can now have, say, spells, which are like, this spell only affects ability check. Not every time you roll a d20 for something, or this spell only affects attack rolls.
Yeah.
And you don't have to have these like complicated language in the spell. You don't have to have all these exceptions to it. You can just say it affects saving throws, and then that's it. This is one of those things that, you see people mistake a spell like Hex for, where they will look at Hex and think like, oh, well, it's going to take their saves and other stuff. And it's like, no, it's just ability checks that they're going to take the penalty on. Even though I think, you know, that I've sat at tables before where you had to explain to a veteran player that it's different now. Like, you can't just assume that the addition is the same just because it kind of like looks the same. Mm-hmm. So that's how I've come across it in my own DMing experience.
But one thing's for sure. There are no such thing as skill checks.
They're not. You know, it's something that I think would probably surprise a lot of people who sort of like look at 5th edition and go like, hey, it looks like previous editions of D&D, like I can just play it. And maybe you bought the player's handbook and you flipped through it, you read the sections on like character creation and stuff, but you know, the middle chapters, adventuring, action resolution, things like that, probably just like skipped past or something. But if you go back and reread it, it's very clear. Not like me, the book's much more clear. It's saying like, listen, you're gonna start with an ability check. And it defines them all, which is why we began our discussion with definitions, sort of like how they're sometimes fuzzy. But it starts with like defining what each ability score covers and then calls upon the DM to say like, hey, anytime the player asks you something that they want to do, you're going to interpret it and say like, it fits into one of these 6 ability scores, the thing that I'm trying to do. And if applicable, you can add your proficiency bonus if you have one of the skills that's associated with that ability score. Mm-hmm. There's a variant rule that lets you mix and match ability scores and skills, which I really like, but that's sort of the base starting point.
Right.
It defines skills as a focused aspect of the ability. But in my play experience, and I know that this is not uncommon, there's a lot of people who sort of identified this issue, is that a lot of players and a lot of DMs, myself included, will still call for skill checks. Will still interact with the game world and each other as if the skill proficiency was the most important part and not the ability score itself. It's a subtle difference. Probably a lot of people are just like, you're nitpicking and this is, you know, it doesn't matter. I kind of think it does, if only because it's it changes how you think about your character, right? Like if you're only thinking in terms of your skills, then you'll eventually only think in terms of your skills. And the player's handbook is calling on players to say like, hey, just describe what you do. Don't even think about your character sheet. And like in some cases, you might even make them turn it over or cover it up or something. Right. And after you've described what you want to do, it's up to the DM to make a ruling. And here are the guidelines for how to make that ruling. This is not, I toggle my stealth aura and sneak through camp. It's, you know, I'm attempting to, you know, move from shadow to shadow, finding cover, avoiding patrols, taking my time, describe what you do, how you use the environment, all those kinds of things. And then the DM might go, well, that sounds like it would use the stealth proficiency, but the way you're approaching this is not nimble and agile. It's, you know, observational. It's patient. It's waiting and looking for patterns or something. That could be intelligence or wisdom, right? Depending on which way you want to describe it and have a focus for that action resolution.
Right, right. Kind of skirting the edge of a disguise check, but like if you have similar colors to a camp that you're sneaking through, like right. Just carrying the aura of like, oh, I'm supposed to be here. Mm-hmm, I mean, to me, that could be like a charisma stealth check.
Certainly.
You're literally just walking through camp. You don't have a uniform or anything.
Yeah.
But you walk like you're supposed to be there.
Walking like you're supposed to be there is a great...
You know, I realize that could be deception.
It could be.
But
this is why the player just describes what they want to do.
Right.
Instead of saying, I want to use my deception. I'm like, and this is a habit that I fall into. It's easy to get into in the same way that it's easy to just, I rolled a 17 to hit. All right, you take 7 damage. Like, it's easy to get in this habit where you're only interfacing with the game rules, especially if you're
right.
Tired, pressed for time, distracted, you know, whatever. They're the part that, you know, you need to communicate clearly to the player, so you sort of like lean back on them. What you're describing is like, yeah, tell me how you sneak across. Like, what's it like? And based on your description, I will then say, make this roll.
Right.
And that gets sort of to the second point, which is that you know, players don't roll for those things independently. They are called for by the DM, and then that's a personal pet peeve of mine. the DM will call for it, and then you make the roll. Because DM might say, no roll needed. You know, you didn't need to roll that.
Yeah, and I think that's where the introduction, or I can't remember if they were in 4th edition or whatever, but passive skills. Passive
sure,
perception,
yeah.
Passive... Passive insight.
I do believe they were in 4th, yeah.
I didn't play it that much. But I do like that for that.
Yeah.
Now I am of the school that believes that just because you've insanely high passive perception, mm-hmm. when it comes time to roll a perception check, that's not your floor.
Yeah.
Right. Like if you're actually like, no, I'm looking out. Well, guess what? If you're telling me you're looking out for things, well, you're looking at multiple things.
Yeah.
And that's a little bit different than a passive perception.
Sure, sure, sure.
And yeah. So, yeah, you can fail because you're just looking at the wrong thing.
Yeah.
So, you know, but I do like that as a groundwork because it does kind of preserve the mystery, mm-hmm. preserves the illusion of realness to it. You know,
sure,
you don't have to point out the thing that's hiding in the corner because they rolled but failed.
Yes, and I have seen that so many times. I mean, I've seen that so many times where it's the, and it almost always is perception. You want the players to like notice a thing mm-hmm. and act on it. Or you know, have it get just ping on their radar. And yeah, if you're asking them to roll, then you need to be prepared to go like, yeah, you don't see the thing I want you to see. And you know what, you can get around that by using the passive scores. Like you said, I sometimes just like, yeah, you notice it, period. Are you conscious?
Then
you
notice or you hear or you see a flicker of something, and at least gives them the idea like something's there, but you don't know what.
Right. Yeah, clues note that they got to do some more investigating.
Right. It could be a pile of treasure, and it could be a predator hiding invisible, you know.
Right. Passive scores are I know Jeremy Crawford has come out and said, yes, they do represent a sort of like floor. They cannot go below this. At least that's the way they're intended to. I think that works weird with like the rogues feature of it that they eventually get, where it's like, yeah, if you roll less than a 10, count it as a 10. So it seems to like step on that, the toes there. Mm-hmm. Mostly for me, it's that the scores that players can get in some skills, particularly those with access to expertise, so far outstrip the monster's abilities to either sneak past them or detect them while they are sneaking. Particularly thinking of perception and stealth in these two areas. Right. It's just so out of whack, so out of balance, that even taking into account things like, oh, well, are they in, you know, dim light and therefore have disadvantage on their perception checks or something like that to notice someone sneaking up on the party? Or are they, you know, do they otherwise have some kind of penalty or something? Like, I mean, I guess, but if you got like expertise and maxed out your stats and, you know, you're high up in levels and maybe you've got advantage on it anyway from something else, or does it matter? You're probably going to make it simply because the monster manual doesn't have great, you know, most of the monsters in the monster manual don't have great stats.
Yeah, because I mean, you get high enough level and you're adding like 14, 15 sure. to a d20 roll.
Sure.
And, you know, your modifier is enough
yeah.
to notice without any kind of passive or anything.
I forgot what Zila's eventual passive perception was, but it was ridiculous. It was in the high 20s.
Yeah.
And I was on purpose. I had expertise, I had observance, and I think I usually also had some other things going on. Anyway, so the counter argument to that is those with access to expertise, that's their special feature. You know, that is their one thing that they do really well, and you would expect a rogue to ghost their way into a place past everyone else.
Yeah.
Whereas even the ranger, even the stealth trained, you know, other people in the party, they're not going to be able to.
Yeah, they know how to walk quietly. They don't know how to be like the cat, quiet as a shadow.
Yes.
You know? I mean, you just don't do that. I mean, yeah, you're the fighter with your action surge attacking 8 times a round.
Right. Yeah, exactly.
But
yeah.
The rogue, he's the guy that snuck past that beholder
right.
with 11 eyes.
Yeah. I go back and forth on it, and sometimes I have monsters that I change their stats to get past those, and sometimes I don't. It's kind of a bit of a digression, you know, about specifically stealth and perception, but I think it plays that way into just about every passive ability. It's not just passive perception. You can have passive investigation, which notice small details, a chance to pick up on certain illusions that mm-hmm. may be there. I use passive stealth all the time.
Yeah.
Where it's just like, how just naturally quiet are you?
Mm-hmm.
Are you, you know, and just, even if you're not trying, are you able to just kind of like be quiet and sneak up on people, that kind of thing?
Yeah, as someone who routinely scares their roommates and coworkers,
right.
I can attest to passive stealth.
Yeah.
Because I scare the shit out of the pharmacist I work with all the time.
Yeah.
Because I just don't make noise when I walk.
Uh-huh.
But I attribute that to martial arts training.
Right.
And again, that's a form of training
yes.
that has probably given me proficiency in stealth.
And so, yeah, probably so. You know, I can certainly see it. And it's a, you know, these are abstractions that we have to deal with because the game is a game. And at some point, we have to reach a level of abstraction because we can't spend all day playing the game as much as we might like to. you know, it, you can't dig into every nitty-gritty detail, because if that were that case, then we're like, all right, well, what's your stat to kind of like steady your breath, and what's your stat for muscle control? And, you know, I've seen games that have 15 abilities, and they take like, there's 5 physical, 5 mental, 5 spiritual, or something like that. And they break down dexterity into agility and manual dexterity, or they break down strength into, you know, being able to deliver a lot of force very quickly versus how long you can sustain, you know, exerting yourself and that kind of thing.
Thwacking versus planking.
Right. In the opposite direction. I've seen somewhere it's just like physicality. All of them are just one stat.
Yeah. You know, your health, your strength, your, yeah, all that.
And so there's all different ways to do it. 6 is the one that D&D has used since pretty much the beginning.
Yeah.
I don't see it going anywhere, but I would say this, that if you are playing the game and sort of thinking about the way your character operates in the game world, and this is mostly for players, to challenge yourself to start thinking about what your character can do, not in terms of the proficiencies they have or the things they're trained in or the class abilities, but just like what you want to do in that moment. Put your character sheet away. Just describe your actions to the DM. And then for the DMs to be open to interpreting what the players are saying, have a conversation with them. Is this what you want your character to do? Do I understand you correctly? What's your intent behind this? And to return to, like, say, the sneaking through camp example, it's like, where are you going? Are you trying to absolutely avoid detection, or you just want to avoid notice?
Right.
You know, that's a big difference. And to get to the intent of what the player wants and then make a judgment call. Is this worth rolling a dice? Is this something that a passive score could handle? And if it's worth rolling, like, what is going to oppose it, and what are we going to roll? All of those things require you to just sort of like give this basic sort of building block of the game some thought, and maybe clarify for everybody, hey, this is what I think about the ability scores. Do you agree, disagree? If only because this way, it involves a lot of interpretation. It involves a lot of, you know, sometimes it's going to be this way, sometimes it's going to be another way kind of moments. And for some players, they can find that frustrating. They want the certainty of, like, every time I roll strength, athletics is going to be this one thing, you know, instead of switching it up all the time or something.
Right, right. Yeah. Well, that's going to happen.
Yeah.
Head on over to Patreon for our weekly podcast and so much more.
Want to see us play? We've got games every week on Twitch, which we upload to our second YouTube channel, WebDM Plays.
If you like the video, hit that subscribe button, click the bell, give us a thumbs up, and tell us in the comments.
Thanks for watching.
Mic's on.
Fam, fam, bo, bam, banana, fana, fo, fam, me, my, mo, mam. Fam.